My name is Tony Janetos. I'm the director here at the Pardee Center for the Study of the Longer Range Future. I'd like to welcome you all this afternoon for the first of a series of seminars on the Conference of Parties for the Framework Convention on Climate Change. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a few minutes. Let me start by saying a few words about the center and then introducing my co-panelists for this afternoon's session. The center is really dedicated to understanding the forces that cause the world to evolve the way it does, to trying to understand those economic, scientific, environmental, political, and cultural forces that are important for understanding the next several decades out to even longer time scales, and thinking about what are the factors that affect changes that we observe and that we are likely to observe in the world. Obviously, climate change is a big part of that. And so we are, as I'll talk about in a few minutes, we're going to sponsor a whole series of events that revolve around climate change, adaptation to changes, and the negotiating process, of which this is the first. I'll say something about the others as we get into the seminar itself. Let me first introduce my co-panelists. On my far left, your far right, is Henrik Selin. Henrik is a professor in the Pardee School for Global Studies, who is co-sponsoring this series with us. Henrik has done a lot of research on international environmental governance, on international environmental treaties, and has been following these negotiations extremely closely. To my immediate left is Kelly Sims Gallagher. Kelly's an expert on China, and China, and in particular, energy policies in China. She is at the Tufts Fletcher School. She has just returned from a year, I was about to say a year abroad, but from spending a year in the White House working on China issues and China cooperation issues, actually in many ways leading up to the big announcement, joint U.S.-China announcements of about a month and a half ago. And so she will discuss the aspects of China in relation to COP21. So without any further ado, let me begin. We're going to talk about prospects for Paris. This is the first in a three-part series on perspectives and issues that lead up to Paris. This seminar today will focus on the U.S., on the EU, and on China. Just before we started, we determined this adds up to about half of anthropogenic energy emissions in the world, just these three entities. Next Thursday afternoon at 3:30 at the Pardee School, there will be the second of our series, which will focus on perspectives from the developing world. So that will be held down the street at the Pardee School, also at 3:30 in the afternoon. And then the third of our sessions on the COP, on the Conference of Parties, will actually come on February the 2nd. Details to be determined, but there what we'll discuss is what actually happened and what lessons should we draw from whatever it is that actually happens at the Paris COP. Intermixed with that will be a number of other events having to do with climate and climate adaptation. In particular, we'll do a symposium on climate adaptation and its relation to natural disaster strategies and resilience on November the 17th up the street at the law school. And so let me encourage you to come to all of these if you're able to. Okay, so now, so what makes this the December Conference of Parties an exercise in continuity? This marks the beginning of the third decade of international climate negotiations under the Framework Convention. This was one of the original Rio Environmental Convention signed at Rio in 1992, and the first conference of the parties was 3 years later, in 1995. And in many ways, in particular, the Climate Change Convention codified the role of scientific assessments in a way that that many of the other conventions actually did not, with the significant exception of the Montreal Protocol and the Convention for the Protection of the Atmosphere against those substances. And many of the issues that were debated at the very beginning of the Framework Convention, both at the Rio Conference and in the first and second and third Conference of Parties, are still being debated. Whether there would be binding targets and timetables, and if so, what did we actually mean by binding? Would there be monitoring of commitments? Would there be sanctions? Was there any prospect for enforcement? And perhaps most importantly, at that time, this notion of differentiated responsibilities, that the industrialized economies bore a different set of responsibilities than nations in the developing world. And this was actually enshrined in the in all of the negotiating processes to follow. Many of these issues are still unresolved, but what makes some of the things that make COP21 distinct are this time everybody plays around emissions reductions. And this is a really important point. The commitments, proposals that are being brought forward by all nations around intended nationally determined contributions are essentially statements of ambition that each nation has for reducing its greenhouse gas emissions. So it's, while they will be different between essentially the large economies, the OECD economies, and countries in the developing world, there is no longer this expectation that only what used to be referred to as the Annex I nations would do something about their emissions, and none of the other countries would. And in fact, this time we're seeing not only that all nations are meant to propose these nationally determined contributions, and we enter COP21 with major nations, the major emitting nations, and political entities, as you might think about the EU, having already made substantial commitments. The EU has had a trading program in place for a number of years. It's perhaps hasn't achieved quite the goals that it set out to achieve, but it nevertheless has made significant achievements in reducing emissions amongst the EU countries. The U.S. has proposed its climate action program. I think the EPA rules will be published on Friday in the Federal Register. But there's no, obviously there's no national legislative agreement on what to do. But for the very first time, there are important and quite tangible commitments on emissions from the major developing countries, from China, from India, from Brazil, and a host of others. In fact, if you look carefully, this is a website called the Carbon Brief. I'll show you the website in a moment. As of last week, out of 196 countries that are signatories to the protocol, about 156 have already made submitted an INDC that account for about 90% of current emissions. So there's actually quite substantial coverage in terms internationally, globally, in fact, of man-made, of anthropogenic greenhouse gas emissions. In this graph, the countries in pink are the ones who have actually submitted a pledge. In gray are countries that have yet to do so. There is another. This is one of the other main sites, NGOs, that is tracking these commitments and their contribution, their calculated contribution to overall global warming. And these are the URLs for those two sites. These slides will be available, of course, for anybody who wants them. These are really quite interesting websites. They're fairly careful in how they've done these kinds of calculations. They've pretty carefully gone through all of the national plans and have a lot of information on the policies, that the countries have proposed to act that are part of their INDC. So what is the U.S. commitment? So the U.S. is one of these, one of the major countries that have made a commitment. And so here are the guts of the commitment. It's somewhere between a 26 and a 28% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions economy-wide. Reduction measured by 2030, measured against a 2005 baseline. So this is actually a fairly this is a fairly substantial commitment. It's largely the result of EPA's clean power rules. It will likely require some new executive action, but no new legislation. There is an ambition to hit the 28% end of the target rather than 26%. It does include land use change in forestry, which in the U.S. is a net sink and is likely to remain a net sink for at least the next couple of decades. These are slightly less ambitious targets than had been discussed in 2010, with one possible exception, which is this target does not include international offsets, which is actually, I think, different than previous U.S. submissions. And more recently, the administration announced that as part of this, there would be an ambition to hit about a 20% mix of non-hydro renewables in the national U.S. energy mix. Currently, we're at about 12%. We have about 8% hydro, about 12% non-hydro. And so this would be a pretty major expansion of non-hydro power renewables over the next couple of roughly decade or so, 15 years. And it would continue to require sort of regular and fairly substantial increases in end-use efficiency in the economy, a lot of which is happening anyway, but likely will require some additional steps. The way this is to be achieved is typical of the Clean Air Act, that the EPA plan sets targets individually by states. The states have a substantial amount of leeway as to how they would actually be implemented. Many states are already resisting. If you read even just this morning's newspaper, there's a fairly lengthy list of states who are preparing lawsuits, which presumably they will file Friday afternoon after the Federal Register notices are published. So the implementation prospects are a little unclear. These types of lawsuits, frankly, are rarely successful, but they can delay implementation. And so there is the EPA has the legal authority to do this. This is being done under that legal authority. I think as a judgment call, I think one could say that there's actually quite a good prospect that these regulations will go into effect, and we'll begin to see them take effect over the next 15 years.
Can I make a friendly amendment?
Yeah.
It's actually by 2025, the U.S. commitment.
Fair enough.
Because when I get to China.
That's the 2030. Sorry. It's a power sector approach, mm-hmm. right? So this leaves out manufacturing. It leaves out transportation. Transportation, for example, is roughly a third of U.S. emissions. Those will require other approaches if they're going to be taken up. But it's largely the power sector that EPA has direct responsibility for. One way to think about this is this would prevent any backsliding of going back to coal, right? Nobody's building coal-fired power plants right now in the U.S. because it's clearly non-economical to do that with natural gas so cheap. This would essentially prevent backsliding and new construction of coal in the U.S. So one big question is, what about this global 2-degree C target? There is what came out of previous negotiations, an agreed-on international target of no more than a 2-degree C annual average increase in global temperatures above pre-industrial levels by 2100. This is often referred to as a scientifically determined target. It is not, right? The actual scientific analysis looks both at at more stringent and less stringent scenarios of rise. But the 2 degrees is a value judgment about what would seem to be acceptable risk. And so there's been an international negotiated decision to accept 2 degrees as an international target. Current emissions, if Paris were to be an abject failure and we were simply on sort of a business as usual path, we probably end up with something like a 4 degrees world. Somewhere around 3.5, 3.6, 3.7, depending on the model, depending on a whole host of uncertainties, but a world that would be very, very different than today. Under current scenarios of what countries have proposed in their national contributions, on the other hand, we still go past 2 degrees C. And so we're somewhere in the 2.5, 2.6, 2.7 degrees C range, still quite a substantial change from pre-industrial conditions and quite a substantial change from today, where we're still at roughly half, at roughly a degree. So there is work yet to be done to hit that 2 degrees C target. There are many people who already feel that it's in the rearview mirror, but there is quite a large difference between a world that is approaching 4 degrees increase and a world that is less than 3 and that is approaching 2. So what will the sticking points be? And here there's not necessarily analysis that I'm going to point to, but I think just judgment based on what we've seen in the past and what we might anticipate as discussion. So this is just my judgment. And one is that I think it's unlikely that the INDCs themselves will actually be the sticking point. They are, after all, meant to be determined individually by countries. Perhaps there's some negotiating room around them. Some of them are for actual decreases. Some of them are for improvements in energy intensity. But this difference between a 3.6 degree world and a 2.6 degree world is a pretty substantial difference by the end of the century. So there may be some quibbling, but these, in my view, are unlikely to be the actual starting point. But they're sticking points. But there are plenty of other major issues, and in particular, financing issues. Financing and technical and tech transfer for clean energy development and financing for climate adaptation measures. These are both have both been quite controversial. There is a major conflict between the developed and developing nations on financing issues. The developed nation economies have basically never funded all the various climate funds at the levels that they promised in the last couple sets of negotiations without doing a substantial amount of creative accounting. And you might think of this as sort of the revenge of mainstreaming and the difficulty of identifying what is a climate investment as opposed to or in addition to other development investments. And so what much of the world is looking for is this additionality, and they're having trouble seeing it. The industrialized nations are saying we've provided the money we promised, or alternatively that the global recession made it too difficult for us to do. And so this is in fact a major conflict amongst all the parties, and likely one that will require some compromise on all sides. So what might we expect? There will be an agreement this time. It's clearly going to be based, the agreement on the emissions side will be based, essentially based on the INDCs. I'm not personally anticipating a lot of movement from them. There might be some, but I'll be surprised if there's a lot. This is a cheap prediction that there'll be no agreement on monitoring or the binding nature of commitments because there never has been in the past. I don't know why we would expect to suddenly achieve that now. And there will be some sort of compromise on financing that will perhaps be better than simply promises to do better. So let me stop there, and let me turn to Henrik. And Henrik will talk about the EU. And then when Henrik is done, Kelly will talk about China. And then we'll open this up for questions and discussion.
I see a couple of people here who I know are familiar with the EU, but all of you might not be, so I just want to sort of set a little bit of a background here that when we do talk about the EU, what do we actually mean? Well, one important thing to remember here that in the EU there's been a very steady growth of membership over time. So when we started this endeavor, when we call it the European Economic Community, we were 6 countries. When we adopted the Framework Convention in 1992, there was 12. When we did the Kyoto Protocol in 1997, there was 15. When we did the sort of Copenhagen Accord in 2009, there were 27. And now going into Paris, we are talking about 28 countries. So in that respect, when the EU sits down and negotiate, they negotiate on behalf of a fairly substantial number of countries. Now, we've all heard a lot about EU failures as of late, about Eurozone crisis and trouble dealing with immigration and xenophobia and slowdown after the economic downturn, haven't really recovered. And all of that is true and all of that is correct and worthy of lots of attention and analysis. But one thing to remember here that when we're talking about trade and environment, the EU is actually doing relatively well. It's actually one of the areas where the EU managed to stick together and have a fairly unified front. So in that sense, there is every expectation that the EU will go into Paris and present a somewhat coherent approach across all 28 member states. We are also talking about a fairly large political and economic actor here. If we tally up the valued annual value of the single market across these 28 countries, we are talking about an $18.5 trillion market in GDP. That's World Bank data from last year. The value of the US is 17.4 and China is 10.3. That is, the value of the EU market is roughly double that of China. So we are talking about a fairly large player here. Now, the EU is also approaching the Paris talks from a fairly different angle from both China and the United States. So as Tony said, if we tally up the percentage share of emissions from China, United States, and the EU, we get to ballpark 45% or so. That means that these three actors are responsible for almost half of global emissions. But if we look at emissions trend from 1990 to 2011, we see that they differ quite dramatically, as in the Chinese emissions have gone up by over 230%. The United States emissions have gone up 7.7, and the fact that it's not more is largely because of the switch away from coal to shale gas. But at the same time, the EU emissions actually went down by 17%. And it's also worth noting the per capita emissions, as in you can see that the EU per capita emissions are considerably lower than those of the United States, and actually not that much higher than China in 2011. And a couple of years from now, when we get good data for 2014, 2015, 2016, we are going to find out that the EU emissions per capita are roughly where China is now. And at the same time, at least in the near future, the EU emissions will continue going down, whereas the Chinese emissions will go up. Hopefully that won't go on forever, and Kelly will tell you about that. But that means that as of about now, the EU per capita emissions are actually lower than the Chinese per capita emissions. Now, Tony mentioned a couple of sticking points, and one of those have been, so what kind of an agreement are we generally striving for? And the EU, throughout this process, have been a fairly strong supporter of a legally binding agreement. They want legally binding approaches to these kinds of things. They backed the Framework Convention in 1992. They backed the Kyoto Protocol in 1997. They were among the ones that wanted to have a legally binding agreement in Copenhagen, but that didn't work out. And they generally prefer a legally binding agreement also in Paris. And if it was up to the EU, but it's not, then the commitment would also have been legally binding. But because of pushback from China and the United States and other countries, that is not possible. But this whole notion of INDCs is not the EU's preferred choice. They would have liked to have them written into the legally binding agreement. They do also support the common but differentiated responsibility principle that Tony also mentioned. But at the same time, they are increasingly clear that they want action, they as in the EU, want action by all the major economies, as in they want China and India and Brazil definitely to do something, but they also recognize that it doesn't have to be exactly what the Europeans or North Americans are doing. It does not have to be as ambitious, but they clearly want to see some meaningful commitments by all major economies. But then we can have a very, very, very long discussion about what meaningful actually means here. They have very different opinions about that. I totally agree with Tony. We will not get a very strong agreement in Paris around monitoring and compliance and those kinds of things. But if we look at actors' positions, the EU is generally on the side of the spectrum of those that are pushing for relatively stringent measures on those kinds of things. So again, if it was up to EU, which again it's not, they would have liked to see a little bit more than what is likely to actually come out in Paris. And if we're talking about climate funding, yes, both public and private actors in Europe will have to be very large contributors towards the $100 billion a year that we were supposed to reach by 2020. Like Tony, I think the only way that we're going to get there is by increasingly creative accounting. But nevertheless, still a lot of that money would have to come out of Europe. Otherwise, there is no way we're going to even get near to that. So if we then look briefly at what the EU has done at home. So the first action on carbon dioxide emissions within the EU was actually in 1991. So that means that they have been active on climate change policy for roughly 25 years now. And they have taken on a number of regionally accepted commitments. So the EU, and then there was an EU 15 when we took the Kyoto Protocol in 1997. The goal there was to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 8% below 1990 levels by 2012. In 2009, the EU 27 ratcheted that up and did their 20 by 20 by 20 by 2020 goal, which means that by 2020, they should be 20% below 1990 levels. And this is a side note, if you remember from when Tony said, the US baseline is 2005. The EU is generally sticking with its 1990 baseline, which means that you can't compare the percentages straight across because they have different baselines. And generally here, the 1990 is the more stringent of the baseline as compared to 2005. If you want to fiddle with your numbers and make it look good, you pick the 2005 baseline. If you want to stick with the baseline that was in the Kyoto Protocol originally, you go with the 1990 ones. So then we're going to cut emissions by 20% below 1990 levels. We're going to have 20% of our energy coming from renewables and a 20% improvement in energy efficiency. And then last year, then the EU 28 ramped it up further and said by 2030, we're going to cut emissions by 40%. And the renewable energy and energy efficiency goals were amped up to 27%. And the sort of the long-term stated goal of the EU and the European Commission here is by 2020, we should basically have decarbonized the European economy, and our greenhouse gas emissions should be roughly 80 to 95% below 1990 levels. So that's the so there's a number of targets and that we have sort of increased over time. So the big question is then, well, how did we do? And so far, the EU is actually coming off pretty good in the sense that not only did we meet the 8% Kyoto target, we actually overshot it but by quite a margin. So by 2012, the EU 15 had reduced their emissions by over 12%. The EU 28 is on track. The European Environment Agency, which is the research body of the European Union that sort of collects all emissions data and published the official EU reports, came out with a report last week that said that already now the EU is actually where they're supposed to be by 2020. So the official data for 2013 shows that they have cut their emissions by 19.8 and they're supposed to be by 20 by 20. The preliminary data for 2004, and I'm stressing this is preliminary, and the European Environment Agency does the same, shows that they're actually 23% below 1990 levels. So in that sense, they are definitely on track to meet that. They have made a little bit less progress on renewable energy and energy efficiency, but the official rhetoric coming out of Brussels is that with the measures that we have in place, we will be there by 2020. So if the European Union is to be believed, they will be there when it comes to their 2020 goals. And if we want to do a nice little graph, you can see it like this. So you can then see that the charts are generally going in the right direction, right? So we are supposed to cut greenhouse gas emissions and improve energy efficiency. They are going down. We're supposed to ramp up renewable energy, and they are going up. And again, this is a figure from the European Environment Agency report that came out last week, so I did not make that particular figure. We can go back to it if you want to. So just to wrap things up here, one thing that is important to note here, I believe, is that while the EU emissions went down 24% from 1990 to 2014, their economy actually grew by 46%. So in that sense, we're actually seeing a real decoupling here. And the 46% would actually probably have been higher if they hadn't been so slow coming out of the economic crisis. So we have 46% with a really sluggish economy, with a Eurozone crisis, with an economy that is not firing all cylinders. So if they'd actually had smarter economic policy coming out of 2008, that number would probably have been even higher. But even so, even struggling economically, there is a clear divergence between greenhouse gas emissions that are going down and an economy that actually gets to grow.
Adjusted for the number of nations now in the EU?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, yes. At the same time, the EU does not have policies in place to take them where they need to be by 2030. So the 2020 goals are clearly within reach. The 2030 goals are actually not. If we go by just what we have in place now, the EU would probably be down by 27% on greenhouse gas emissions by 2030, which means there's a gap of 13. So somehow they need to come together and strengthen their measures. And there's increasingly question whether they can actually do that or not. You have relatively large member states, Poland, for instance, being one of them, that are increasingly saying, well, you know, this is an ambitious target, but we are not sure exactly how much we can contribute to it. Because one thing to also keep in mind here is that the EU very much operates on the basis of effort sharing. So that means that they have all of these collective targets. So for instance, the 2020 target is the EU collectively should cut their emissions by 20%. Now, one way to do that was to mandate that all countries cut their emissions by 20%, and collectively we will be at 20%. But they have said, no, that doesn't make sense because we are fairly, not globally, but within the region, there is still a fairly diverse number of countries. Our socioeconomic conditions are very different. There is difference in GDP per capita and all of that. So some countries will take on a greater responsibility, which then gives some other countries a leeway to not cut their emissions by the same amount. And the renewable energy target is the same. Not every country needs to have 20% of their energy coming from renewable sources. We have also differentiated that. And the EU is doing that for two reasons. One, because it's the right thing to do. Countries are different. It's sort of the European version of common but differentiated responsibility. The other reason is that if they continued or pressed for a uniform approach, they couldn't agree on anything whatsoever. So it's also politically necessary to do that. You simply have to give countries different targets, some more stringent than others, or they would not be able to agree on any kind of collective target. So the EU tends to, of course, stress it's the right thing to do, but there is a very hefty dose of realpolitik underpinning all of this, that they actually need to do it in order to move forward. They have also been struggling in some other areas. There have been a longstanding goal of having a common energy market, as some of you know, and we are not making a lot of progress on getting there. So there are some real question marks whether the EU can be where they need to be by 2030, and also, of course, then by 2050. And the sort of final point here, the big question is then that even if then EU measures are relatively ambitious within industrialized countries, even if the EU is doing relatively well among the industrialized countries, is it still enough to take us where we need to go? Tony already hinted that we will most likely miss the 2 degree Celsius target. So if we actually want to be more aggressive about that, then the EU actually also need to be more aggressive.
Great. Thank Great. You. Kelly?
Thank you. Those, you two might want to come in. No? Okay. Well, I thought I would talk briefly about the overall negotiations, if you don't mind, for a few Please. Minutes, and then talk a bit about China. So there's a number of major issues that remain. In fact, a lot of major issues that still remain to be resolved for Paris. So just to begin with, the text itself is still really complicated. I took a look at it this morning, and there's something like 55 pages of text and 12,055 brackets in the text. Many of the articles have, you know, option one, option two, option three, and there's, you know, very little overlap between the options. And so there's still a huge amount of work to be done to resolve the text. On Wednesday at Fletcher, we'll be having the two co-chairs of the negotiations giving a talk at 5:30. So if any of you are interested, you need to RSVP through the Fletcher website. But they're the ones responsible for trying to whittle down the text and remove those brackets and reach consensus. I think that there's five sticking issues right now. One is the legal form of the agreement. This is a contentious issue because some countries do not want a legally binding agreement for various reasons, and others very much do want to have, you know, an internationally legally binding agreement. The U.S. position is that this is a bottom-up process, and especially using the approach of these intended nationally determined contributions, that's essentially a voluntary approach, the so-called pledge and review system, where countries are making a pledge, a voluntary commitment, and then it's up to them to meet this voluntary commitment. And under such a system, the United States would not be obliged to submit for Senate ratification. But there may be some components of the system, of the agreement in whatever form it comes in, that would be legally binding, even if these, you know, targets and timetables are not. And those might be covered under the convention, which the United States has already ratified. So different countries have different points of view on this issue, and it's far from resolved. As both of you have already mentioned, the finance issue, I think, is really probably the most challenging one for this conference of parties. It's extremely difficult to add up the numbers. Some of us have tried, and there's, you know, whole organizations now devoted to this this kind of work. But the commitment of $100 billion by 2020 was meant to be a year, yeah, was meant to be a public and private commitment. And the developing countries, by and large, I think, would prefer that to be public money, that they can count and track, because the public money is easier to measure. But even so, we're having a fairly hard time. So in retrospect, I think it was really a mistake to not develop an accounting system for how to track the finance earlier, and a system that was bought into by the developing countries and helped, you know, they should have helped design that system, because now there's so much dispute about what's being counted and what's not being counted. And of course, it's almost impossible to determine the private sector funding. So I think many, you know, experts think we've already actually exceeded the $100 billion in public and private finance, but it's extremely difficult to prove it. So this is really a challenge. On the other hand, I think we had a really terrific breakthrough with the Chinese commitment, their recent pledge in the context of the U.S.-China joint statement last month of a commitment to spend $3.1 billion. They had to slightly exceed the U.S. pledge of $3 billion. and that's a really important breakthrough because it's the first major commitment from a developing country to provide climate finance. And it's very much in line with the idea, which has sort of become the U.S. position, that all countries in a position to do so should contribute what they can. So that there shouldn't necessarily be, you know, quantified targets for the finance country by country, but rather everyone who sort of is able to help support this transition to a low carbon resilient society should try.
Did China have a deadline for that? Or?
They're saying it's effective immediately.
Okay.
And it does not. It will not go through the Green Climate Fund. They are establishing a separate complementary fund called the South-South Fund on Climate Change. A very sticky issue is the loss and damage issue, the so-called loss and damage. This is really about trying, the least developed countries trying to establish a system for liability and compensation. So, for example, if a small island state loses a portion of their country to sea level rise, they would like to be compensated financially. And this is a really tough one. It's like fraught with many ethical but also very practical problems. At what point did a country that was emitting assume liability? You know, at what point was it known for sure that what they were doing was causing harm? How do you attribute that harm directly? Very difficult. So,
Do you send the bill?
Yeah, to whom do you send the bill? And of course, who's going to sign up to an agreement where you might be taking on that liability? It's a complete non-starter. So it is a little puzzling that these countries keep pursuing this, which I perfectly understand from an ethics point of view, but from a sort of strategic point of view of getting an agreement and moving forward on emissions reductions, it's counterproductive because no country will want to sign up to that kind of a regime. I think the long-term goal is an interesting question. There's a lot of interest in moving beyond the two-degree goal because nobody really can intuitively understand what is a two-degree temperature change and what does that really mean for me or for my country or for you. So there's been different efforts that have been, or different concepts have been proposed. One is decarbonization, another is deep decarbonization, climate neutral by a certain date, or net zero emissions by a certain date. And in my view, none of these are all that useful. Similar to the 2 degree, hard to actually pin that down as something that's measurable. And so in my view, intermediate targets, or sometimes they're called the medium term targets, would be more helpful just so that we provide more certainty in the, you know, medium term to the private sector to know here's where we're going in the short term and here's where we're going in the medium term, so the private sector can start making sound decisions. The technology transfer issue, which is something I've worked on a lot in my career, is an almost impossible issue to resolve in the context of the convention. And I see no way out. I think that they will probably just drop it entirely. But if they do have any text, it will be very vague text. And the last one is the gap, as they call it. And that is this difference between what all these INDCs add up to and 2 degrees. So, you know, you said 2.6. I believe you, but it's very, very hard for anyone to know for sure whether these INDCs, you know, can quantifiably like add up to a certain temperature. We can sort of have a certain degree of confidence and assign probabilities to that. But I have to say, this whole discussion and debate feels silly to me. We should never have expected that an international agreement with 196 countries would be able to effectively resolve global climate change and solve it forever so that we didn't have to do anything else after Paris. I mean, this is a long-term process. Paris will be one important step in a long-term process. And I think we need to understand that we must have Paris provide essentially a floor for future action. I hope it's not a de minimis floor where it's so trivial that we can't even say it's a success. But so long as there's an international agreement that provides sort of a foundation, then we have two options.
We can, at that point, build on it through regular review and revision of the targets, which I think many people are pushing for. Or we can start doing complementary endeavors, bilateral agreements, mini multilateral agreements with smaller sets of countries that can sort of build on the progress made in Paris. And secondly, pursue aggressively domestic climate policy, you know, at the national and subnational level. And I really think that's the post-Paris agenda, is trying to sort of build a whole landscape on top of whatever happens in Paris, and try to create sort of a coalition of the willing, countries and people and towns and cities who are willing to just be more aggressive than is required by the Paris Agreement. Which brings me to China, because I think China is a really interesting example of a country that has profoundly changed its approach to climate policy in the last 10 years. China very much wants Paris to succeed. I think it has been working actively behind the scenes to do that through its own coalitions, the G77 in China, the BASIC countries, but also now through its sort of new alliance. I don't know if we can go so far as call it as an alliance, but new initiatives with the United States. So I think we've already demonstrated that the United States and China are trying to together shoulder the responsibility and take leadership in these negotiations by announcing their INDCs really early, more than a year ago now. And then also, most recently, I don't know how many of you read the joint statement between the U.S. and China, but a third of the joint statement tried to provide a vision for Paris. And if you read it carefully, for those of you who are, you know, real UNFCCC nerds, you will see that we tried to articulate, and here I was part of this process, you know, landing zones for Paris on certain issues, and to try and show a pathway forward on certain issues to help catalyze breakthroughs more broadly in the negotiations. And indeed, actually, in the first joint announcement where we announced our targets, China went to Lima and said, hey, everybody, we've solved the CBDR, the Common But Differentiated Responsibility issue, because we've embodied it. The United States accepted a very different type of target from China. It acknowledged that China has different conditions and circumstances, and the United States, you know, has adopted a more traditional target. So China's target actually looked very different from the U.S. 26% to 28% below 2005 levels by 2025. China announced it would peak around 2030. It would achieve a 20% non-fossil primary energy target also around 2030. And that's what was in the joint announcement. It said it would make best efforts to peak early, and the United States correspondingly said it would make best efforts to hit the 28%, the higher end of the range. Later, when China submitted its formal INDC, it added two more targets. One was the 60 to 65% reduction in carbon intensity and an afforestation target. So you put all of that together and you can see that they have comprehensively looked at this. In the most recent joint statement with the United States, to make another point, I think the effort we were trying to articulate was that both countries are already conceptually moving past Paris and working on implementation. So China announced a national emissions trading system, and they announced the scope of the emissions trading system, which sectors would be covered. Both countries announced new rulemakings on heavy-duty vehicles, and we will actually from now on be synchronized so that our rulemaking process will begin at the same time and finalize at the same time. So now we've got coverage on power sector through the U.S. Clean Power Plan and China's emissions trading system, light-duty vehicles, the CO2 performance standards from the first term, and now heavy-duty vehicle standards. And China, through its emissions trading system, is also addressing its major industrial sector. So I think what we're trying to show is that both countries are just already moving forward on implementing these targets. And there's a means now through the bilateral agreement to do that no matter what. Mm-hmm. So no matter what happens in Paris, the US and China have made these commitments to each other. And we'll now be working forward and working together, I think, very constructively. And this is sort of exciting to me, at least, because it just shows that these countries are taking a leadership role, which I think is a very different situation from Copenhagen and even from Kyoto. And that gives me a lot of hope. So on that note, I'll stop here and maybe we can take questions.
Great. So first, let's thank the panelists. But I would like to open this up to questions and discussions. And if you don't mind, I'd like to ask the first question. You know, there was a point after Kyoto when this notion of a whole series of potential bilateral agreements was floated, and essentially nothing happened. There was some discussion between North America and Latin American countries that there would be some sort of agreement on carbon. Not a whole lot really came out of that. What's changed to, I mean, this is now essentially the embodiment of that ambition. What's changed to allow that to emerge?
Well, I think two things. This is just a personal opinion. I would say one is just pragmatism, that understanding that it is so difficult with so many countries, and maybe this was a lesson learned from Copenhagen, to reach an agreement in the UNFCCC context, that we've got to start looking at other options and still have a commitment to the UNFCCC process. I mean, these are not mutually exclusive. This is not a zero-sum game. I think we showed that the bilateral agreement between the U.S. and China was catalytic for the UNFCCC process. And then I also think in terms of the U.S.-China agreement, there's like this idea in negotiation theory of ripeness, and that sometimes the time is ripe. And I think there was a good recognition in both countries that China was ready for a whole set of reasons, and the U.S. was also ready for a whole set of reasons. And they weren't ready before, but they were ready now. And it was possible to sort of recognize that ripeness and pounce on it and take advantage of it.
Great. So I've got 1, 2, 3, and then 4. Les, you're first.
Thanks.
So can I ask people to use the microphone because we are webcasting this?
Is this working?
Yes.
No, take your word for it. So this is kind of for all of you. There are really 4 tiers of outcome indicators. 1, are you spending enough money? Mm-hmm. 2, are you meeting your contribution targets? 3, is the world meeting its delta T target? And 4, are we getting few enough hard climate impacts like Patricia's and Katrina's and or potential climate impacts or changes in the Gulf Stream or really droughts, horrible things that occasionally pop out of the climate system. Do the participants in Paris, do you think that they generally understand that this is an adaptive process and that we might have some shocks?
Well, I'll start. I won't speak to so much to the diplomatic part of that. If by this time, in the start of the third decade of negotiations, the countries don't understand that this needs to be an adaptive process, and somebody's really not been paying attention. I think the problem with the indicators that you propose is that only potentially 2 of them are actually measurable. in real time, sort of how much money you're spending, and I forget the second. The delta T is always going to be a calculation. It's always going to be fraught with all sorts of uncertainties. It's a model output. It, in a sense, is based on this notion that there is this sort of magic number out there. And I'm increasingly frustrated with that notion, both sort of scientifically and as a spur to meaningful action, because of the implication that it's an abject catastrophe if you don't get there, and you should spend an infinite amount of money not to go past it. Neither of which I think.
Whether you get there, it's
enough. And whether you get there, that it's enough. And so none of which I think is you can. Bank on. And then the third thing is that the problem with the impacts-based measures is that we already have a substantial amount of warming built into the system simply based on past emissions. It is inevitable that we will continue to see increasing impacts for decades to come. And I think the realization of that really over the last 10 years in the negotiating forums makes this investment and adaptation just incredibly important to, in a sense, mitigate harm at the same time as we're choosing to reduce risk for future impacts. But, you know, telling people that we're putting the world in a position not to suffer climate impacts would be just irresponsible on a level that's sort of hard to imagine. So anyway, that's my polemic.
Yeah. No, I think that if we can go down to the individual negotiators, that they understand that it is an adaptive process. The problem you have, though, is that national interests are so incredibly entrenched in this whole process. So it's one thing to sort of know something on a very fundamental level, and it's a slightly different thing to necessarily act on that, especially since that there are many, many, many other interests. So Kelly alluded to the text. So there was the big meeting in Bonn last week, and it actually made me rather depressed on how little progress they made. And you might even argue that we backslided. They actually started with a shorter text than they ended up with, right? So even if they understand this, it came through the process where countries still started to put in their pet issues and their pet brackets and say, oh no, that needs to be there, or that needs to be there, or that needs to be there. They are simply not showing the level of willingness to compromise that is needed. And I'm not pointing any finger here. You can probably say that for all 196 of them.
Yeah.
Okay. I do have a question for each one of you, but I also wanted to point out that answering to your question, there is an importance of the pressure of the public opinion that was triggered by the release of a documentary called Dom. A couple of years ago, some months after it was released, there was about 200 million that had watched that documentary. And that documentary dwelt on the effects on health of the emissions and the pollution that China, especially the cities, suffer every day. My question, so it's important to understand the pressure that is exercised from social networks, websites, and so on and so forth in China due to the lack of political freedoms. My questions are for, Dr.
Selin,
sorry, which countries in Europe are the ones who are slacking and why? And which ones are the ones that are really pushing for more efficient policies? And my question to Dr. Gallagher, thank God I actually remember that one, is do you think that if there's a change in the government in the United States and meaning the Republicans win in the next elections, do you think that the commitment will remain or it will vanish?
Go ahead.
Or should I start? Okay, sure. So one thing I want to point out first is we can't really talk about a clear dividing line between Eastern Europe and Western Europe. It's not the Eastern Europeans are bad and the Western Europeans are good. We're not seeing that. Mm-hmm. So slightly dependent on which particular environmental issue, you're having leaders in Eastern Europe and Western Europe, and you have laggards in Eastern Europe, right? So you don't have a clear block politics here. But if we break it down to climate change, Poland is definitely among those countries that are dragging their feet a little bit. They just had an election where a decidedly more EU skeptical party took over. So that will probably not have a net positive effect on the Polish opinion on these kinds of things. Poland also rely fairly heavily on coal. They are among those countries that in Europe, relatively few that see a future in fracking. So there are a number of sort of political things there. Mm-hmm. Other countries, Hungary, Romania, I would sort of put in that category too. Mm-hmm. Spain and Italy are also sort of starting to come to the point where they think that okay, we have done our bits now. It's sort of time for others. Mm-hmm. And part of the problem that they also have within the EU that so far a lot of those good numbers that you're seeing. Mm-hmm. Are to a very high extent coming down to Germany and the UK. Yeah. And it's one thing to pick the low-hanging fruit, which is what you do at the beginning, and it's a different thing to keep accelerating. So right now we are sort of within the EU collectively benefiting on the Germany going way beyond where they're supposed to be, the UK going way beyond where they're supposed to be, Sweden too, but it's a small country. But these countries can't keep dragging forever. It's going to be more and more difficult. And then you're going to need the other large countries like France or Spain or Italy to step up. And we are not really seeing that.
Do you think that the situation, the economic crisis, sorry, do you think that the situation that the peaks are, the economic situation they are in, is one of the reasons why these countries are slacking?
I think it's part of it, and I think it's also part of it because you mentioned public opinion, and public opinion for these more aggressive measures differ quite dramatically across countries. So there is not sort of a uniform European opinion in that sense, and where you are economically will impact this, right? Yeah. So if you want to be the next prime minister in Greece, I'm not sure why anyone would want to be that, but if you want to be the next prime minister in Greece, running on a very aggressive climate change platform is probably not the one you want to run on, right? And similar with growing unemployment in Spain, what's the youth unemployment now? Is it 25 or 30% or something along those lines?
46%.
46, there you go, right? That's also gonna impact, you know, the political discourse around these kinds of issues.
Various depending on the region you're talking about.
On the U.S. Election, I guess I have two things to say. The first is that no matter who wins, whether it's a climate progressive or a climate skeptic, in order to meet the high end of the range, additional action will be needed. So that could happen through state level action, subnational action. It could happen through greater deployment of cleaner energy technologies than like we expect in the models. You know, the cost of some of these technologies have come down so fast, we may have greater deployment, just market uptake of renewables, for example, than expected. But also additional policy measures are going to be needed. I think, you know, that's just necessary. For someone to undo all the rulemakings that have been promulgated during this administration, it's not an easy task. So it would have to be a very determined president, because just like we go through a rulemaking process of announcing a draft rule and having public comment and having to respond to every public comment and then issuing a final rule, you have to go through that same process to undo rules or to change those rules. And so it's administratively complex. It would take a long time. and a lot of determination. So for that reason, I actually feel pretty confident that the rulemaking processes that are in place and that survive core challenges should prove pretty durable by 2025.
I guess we could say we haven't seen sufficient attention spans amongst
all the candidates. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying it would take a very determined administration to undo everything that the Obama administration has done.
You can starve things too.
You can starve programs too by just not
giving them money, right? So you don't necessarily have to roll back the rules. You can just say, hey, there's no money for it.
Or the alternative, and one that we'll likely see, is the states tie implementation up in the courts for a while, because that's what happens really with every big environmental rulemaking, is they have to survive that period. They almost always do. But, you know, in the long run, if you hit 26% in 2028 instead of 2025, you'd be hard-pressed to actually say that that mattered. So we had a question over here before going back again.
Hi, thanks to the panel for great presentations, and I take home the message that the EU will have less emissions per capita than China, which I didn't know. I have a general question for the panel and a specific question for Kelly. So the general question is on investment. So everyone says investment is a big hurdle, the 100 billion, whether it's real or monopoly money or what's gonna happen. But my question is, why does it matter? And I'm going to qualify. I mean, we're talking 100 billion in 2020, and right now, if you want to divide the updates into adaptation, mitigation, and all the slices of the pie, any item, for instance, renewables, where I come from, will be at the most 20 billion if lucky. Today, or last year, renewables had an investment of 240 billion. That's going to increase. So why would it matter those 100 billion in 5 years from now, when you already have existing investments surpassing farly this and likely to grow? And then the specific question was on this synchronization of rule setting. How would that work in practice? Like, do they notify each other, or like, I'm going to set a new standard for tires for trucks? Or how does it work in practice? Thank you.
Well, I'll tackle both of those. I mean, that was sort of what I was trying to say about the climate finance. I think most experts already think we're well past the $100 billion right now in 2015. It's just very hard to quantify, you know, exactly where that investment came from and where it went to. So we can have these aggregate numbers of like renewables spending, but to prove it, you know, to the developing countries, there's no accounting system, and that just makes it very, very difficult. In terms of the synchronization of rulemakings, we've just agreed at the same time we will begin our rulemaking process and we will conclude it at the same time. In practice, it's been very common, all the countries actually often study each other's rulemaking processes. You know, U.S. studies Europe's, Europe studies United States, Japan, China has frequently done that in the past, and so I expect it will be no different. But there's no harmonization here. We're not, there was no discussion of harmonization. That's not in the agreement. It's just the notion that we're stepping forward at the same time and covering the same sectors basically at the same time is very important. If you think about it from a competitiveness point of view, it eliminates the incentive for firms to move to China because, you know, there's standards here, but there aren't standards there. And it also should mostly, unless there's big differences in the standards, eliminate emissions leakage. So I think for both reasons, this is a very constructive approach.
Yeah. And what sectors are covered, or what?
Well, the only explicit synchronization was on heavy-duty vehicles, but just as I was saying at the end, if you think about it, the power sector is now covered in both countries. You've got the Clean Power Plan in the United States and the National Emissions Trading System in China. You have light-duty vehicles and heavy-duty vehicles, so most of transportation now covered in both countries. And then China is now ahead of the United States in clarifying the scope of their emissions trading system will cover their major industrial sectors, whereas we're not doing that yet. So, you know, in terms of the major emitting sectors, there's now coverage in both countries.
We got one back here, and then we'll come back up here.
Hi, Dr. Selin.
Yes.
You said that something is sort of holding back renewable energies in the EU. Do you know if it's just a matter of policy subsidies, or does it lack the kind of innovative spirit we have here in the US?
So again, the 20 target for renewable energy is sort of a collective target across all of them, right? But within that, the highest target there is Sweden. Sweden is supposed to have 50%. And then there are a couple of countries that are just above 10%. So it really differs from just over 10 up to 50%. So the politics and policy of renewable energy is extremely different across the continent, and you have very, very different debates. The only reason Sweden can be up there is because it has ample hydropower and have invested in biodiversity in biofuels, I was going to say. Whereas then other countries that are less endowed with sort of natural resources that easily makes renewable have much less. And also as I alluded to, I'm not an energy expert, but for a very long time, the sort of energy system and electricity system have developed in a national context. And it's actually somewhat difficult to send from one country to another because their systems are actually not connected. So one of the things that the European Commission wants to do through the energy market is to make sure that that can flow like any other goods. Some countries are then fearing that, okay, prices might go up, but they might lose their sovereignty over their own net and all of that. So there's definitely some pushback. So I would say at least in the sort of more short term, it's largely political will and policy and investment as opposed to it being technologically difficult or technologically impossible.
Thank you.
So actually, I mean, in reference to that, one of the really interesting things that I learned actually as I was doing my homework for this about the U.S. proposal was this goal of getting to 20% exclusive of hydro in renewables. You know, to go from 8 to 20, go from around 8%, around 12%, I guess, which is where we are now, to 20, nearly doubling in a decade, is really quite substantial progress. And if that took us up to, you know, say if hydro stayed roughly the same, you're in the 25 to 28% range for renewables in the total U.S. energy mix. That's really quite a substantial fraction, given the way the energy system in this country works right now. It's a pretty substantial change.
Can I ask a question of Kelly?
Yeah.
Okay. So this was.
And then we have one more. Then we
should
come up.
So this
here.
Is not my argument. Someone else wrote it, and I can't for the life of me remember who it was. But it was someone who has worked fairly long on climate change and emissions trading, mm-hmm. and who were basically fairly skeptical of a national emissions trading scheme in China. And the argument was, for this to work, you need to have really good domestic institutions. Mm-hmm. You need to make sure, you need to verify, you need to make sure there's no corruption and everything is done correctly and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And this person, whose name I can't remember, basically made the argument that China is definitely not there yet. And it would have been much better for China to do like a carbon tax. That would have been much easier to implement in a country like China. And there's sort of every expectation to think that emissions trading in China would be rife with cheating and corruption. And it sounds good on paper, but it's likely to collapse even worse than it did in Europe simply because the institutions are not there. You have worked on China a lot. What's mm-hmm. your take?
I'm concerned. I am similarly concerned. I've written, maybe it was me you read.
It wasn't you, actually. That I would have remembered.
I mean,
your name I remember.
I think the problem is that, as you just said, you need to have very strong institutions for emissions trading to work. However, I don't think China made this decision lightly. They have been experimenting with 7 pilot cap and trade regions for the last 5-year plan. They set up 7 separate exchanges around the country, and some of them are very large in terms of the volume of trades and entities. So they've learned a lot about what they've done. And you know, the other thing I'd say is that we don't really know why governments choose the policies that they choose. I think it's actually, from a scholarly point of view, something I'm really interested in working on now is, what is the policy diffusion process? Why does a government like China decide we're gonna adopt cap and trade? But my real point is, these are nationally determined. These are truly nationally determined. And if China wants to go in this direction, they want to go in this direction. I don't think that there's any ulterior motive. I think they're sincere Sure. about wanting to reduce emissions. If I could have chosen, I would have picked a carbon tax. I just think a price instrument is much easier to administer in China. But they didn't choose that, and so a task before us is to, you know, work with China on ensuring that the system has as much integrity as it can. And I think one of the good things that about China announcing it in the context of the U.S.-China joint statement is that it affords us an opportunity to have the two countries work together on how do you design a good emissions inventory and emissions monitoring system and enforcement, things the United States is actually good at. And to, you know, see if we can work together on that, maybe with a view towards an eventual linkage of the systems over time.
Great.
Two questions. Sure. Uh-huh. Could you explain what kinds of goals would be suitable for and might be adopted by Niger and Mali, Bangladesh, India? And my second question is technology. You've barely mentioned it, a little bit around the corners. Why is it being left out? Should it be left out and just let the goals of renewables and energy efficiency, et cetera, propel technological change? Or should there be some explicit goals? Think about how things have changed since 1990 to 2015 in terms of solar power costs and other renewable costs and conservation, fuel efficiency in cars. Should they be part of this agreement?
You want to start?
Okay. Two great questions. I did mention technology. I was the one who did. I think, you know, it is really hard to figure out how you embed technology into an international multilateral agreement like this. And I've actually been thinking about this for a really long time. And I've come to think, this is just a personal opinion, not a U.S. government position, that the most important thing and the most constructive approach for the big multilateral process like this is to set these targets. And once you have the targets, then you know, every country must establish implementing policies, and those policies are market forming. You're not gonna have the technology deployment unless these technologies are competitive naturally in the marketplace. And most of the time they're not, because they're competing against really cheap coal or, you know, other types of conventional energy. And so they either need some kind of subsidy, or you need to tax the bad and account for the environmental externality. So we need these market formation policies, and I wrote a whole book about this. Once you have the market formation policies, you see, then that natural market incentive occurs. And investors will come into the marketplace if they know that they can get a return on investment in, you know, solar, for example. So to specify which technologies, you know, this has been the advocated approach by many of the developing countries, is to specify certain technologies, compulsory licensing, compulsory IP. It's just not going to happen in a multilateral context, in my opinion.
Specifying technologies is ridiculous.
But right. It is something that has been the...
You can still say, we want to have a 5% annual reduction in solar costs, that's our target, or wind or something like that, or 10% increase per year in fuel efficiency of cars.
Yeah, well, you could certainly set targets like that. There's also... They're trying to negotiate investment targets in renewable energy right now. So there's different approaches like that. Again, they're going to be goals, and so you're still going to need the implementing policies. On the Niger, Mali, Bangladesh, the highly vulnerable countries. I actually think we've been terribly neglectful of these countries, you know, just in a macro sense. When I was in the administration, I helped establish a new public-private partnership called Climate Services for Resilient Development, with the express aim of harnessing the climate data and information that we have in the United States, in the government, and in the private sector, and helping countries like these become more resilient to climate change. Bangladesh is one of the countries in the first round. But in the international agreement, the developing countries have just only advocated for money and not really for the more, I think, more difficult, more complicated needs that they have of how do they do better planning, how do they harness the information that they need, how do they get access to, you know, downscale climate models. And I don't think... the industrialized countries have done a good job of recognizing that there's this tremendous need. I mean, it is inevitable that these countries are going to be, and are, in fact, are already experiencing impacts. And we're not doing a good job helping them. I mean, a personal opinion.
And one of the things you can put into, if you're talking about their INDCs, it can focus on renewable energy. Expanding various forms of renewable energy, which I'm not talking necessarily about large renewable energy projects, but actually more at the household level, at the village level. And I think one advantage, if you do that and that's their target, that would give them a very clear justification for then asking for money, for asking for the $100 billion. Someone asked, was it you? $100 billion, right? Because really, we're not talking about $100 billion totally. Globally here, right? We're talking about $100 billion for developing countries, right? That should go to projects in developing countries. In that sense, what Spain or Sweden does here, that doesn't really matter, but that doesn't count towards those $100 billion, right? And if you link the two, if you have more developing countries that take on at least some ambitious things that they can do for renewable energy expansion, then they can go to the United States or the EU or the Chinese fund or the Green Climate Fund and say, hey, you know, we took on this goal and now we need help to implement it. Help us.
In fact, if you look at India has just announced their INDC. I don't know if it's been formally submitted yet, but... I mean, a big chunk of their INDC was actually a goal for energy intensity. It wasn't an emissions goal, but it was a goal for energy intensity. Yes.
And solar
and increasing forest cover. So some fraction of the developing countries who've submitted their INDCs have set for themselves explicit goals on climate adaptation. And rather than... You know, I mean, let's be honest. It doesn't matter much to emissions what Mali decides to do. It just, it's not going to matter. On the other hand, for countries that are at serious risk, like Mali, it matters a great deal what kinds of adaptation measures they're able to take. So this whole question about the $100 billion is really an argument over additionality.
Right.
You know, show us the additionality. The technology question I think it's actually more complicated than Kelly made it sound. The negotiating history did take, in some sense, took a swing at this one years and years ago with the Clean Development Mechanism, which wasn't initially targeted at technology per se, but was widely regarded to be an abject failure. Far too complicated, actually inhibited. I talked to a number of business people during that time who were just incredibly frustrated because they viewed the bureaucratic nature of the CDM as actually inhibiting technology transfer, trade, a whole host of actions that they otherwise would have been prepared to take at the time.
That's one of the fears I have with the Green Climate Fund that is just supposed to kick in. Exactly how bloody difficult will it be to
rules,
actually get money out of
it? The rules really matter a lot. There is a long history, just in U.S. regulatory history, of different approaches to technology. There's big chunks of the Clean Air Act that essentially mandate best available technology, all of them implemented over the whales that this would bankrupt the nation or at least bankrupt the energy industry. None of that's turned out to be true. They've all resulted in essentially spurring technological development. As soon as it was economically profitable and sensible for those kinds of investments to be made. In my previous job, I had a staff person who did a substantial amount of work on what are the actual patterns of investments, R&D, in energy technologies. And to no great surprise, both public investments and, to the extent that you can understand them, private investments essentially track the price of crude oil. When crude is cheap, they're low. When crude is expensive, they're high. And so right now, we're in this phase where very few entities, either public entities or private entities, are investing anything like what you might expect that would be adequate for the challenge. And so it's a really complicated landscape that we're in.
Well, it could be anything. I mean, my point is it could be the regulatory approach. You know, Tony's example is a perfect example of a market formation policy, the Clean Air Act. You know, it could be a carbon tax. It could be an emissions trading system. Whatever it is that creates an incentive for and certainty for the private sector to make investments and get a return on investment would work.
Yeah. It's a price, I think, rather than the actual instrument that and some certainty on the price rather than an instrument, the particular instrument that implements it.
To Tony's point, one of the regions where we're seeing a fairly heavy investment in renewable and solar is the Middle East. Mm-hmm. Because Saudi Arabia can't live off oil forever, they recognize, and so does the United Arab Emirates and whatnot. So there are one region in the world that invests a lot of it currently.
There we go. Any other questions? Or are we, Cynthia, how are we doing on time?
One last question. That clock is actually 5 minutes slow. So.
Okay, so one last question. You get the last one.
My question is about voluntary approaches for measuring, reporting, and monitoring mechanism. So in a voluntary basis, how we can inject accountability, how we can push countries to set their national, subnational indicators. Yeah, thank you.
So I've done a lot of work, actually, on indicators, both for climate impacts, for climate responses, both adaptation responses and mitigation responses. In one sense, this problem of how is progress going to be evaluated? The countries, after all, are proposing their own contributions. In the U.S., it's a legally binding program, right? I mean, we will know whether the U.S. meets its goals or doesn't meet its goals. It will be part of our regulatory apparatus. I suppose that the expectation is that for the EU, for China, for India, that they will also need to, for their own purposes, establish appropriate indicators and metrics to understand the progress that they're making. You know, in one sense, that's the beauty of this sort of pledge system, that if it's an empty pledge, you know, there's a significant blow to your credibility internationally. And so I think there is some motivation for countries to actually measure their own progress.
I think this is a really difficult issue, made much more difficult by the fact we have so many different types of targets. You know, when you're trying to compare the relative effort of these different countries, it's very hard to compare these different targets. One way we were trying to do it when I was in the administration was looking at the pace of change. So, you know, what's the annual pace of emissions reductions or annual pace of improvement in carbon intensity? And, you know, for example, and this was completely by accident, in the post-2020 period, both the United States and Europe have exactly the same annual pace of emissions reductions implied in their targets, 2.8%. So we'll be able to start tracking these kind of macro indicators, I think, right away. An advantage of targets like the 20% non-fossil primary energy target for China is similar. We'll be able to see whether China's on track or not, depending on how much renewables and nuclear and hydro they're building. between now and 2030. But it's analytically intensive, and there's just going to be so many different types of targets. It's not going to be easy. I'm very skeptical we'll have sort of some like inner, you know, multinational UNFCCC compliance mechanism. I almost cannot imagine it.
It's almost inevitable that there won't be. If you just look at what the INDCs are now, I think there are sufficient topics for many cubic feet worth of paper of master's theses and PhD theses. You have targets that are based on a base year, like the U.S. You have targets that are based on a projection, that is a deviation from business as usual, which is, I think, India's. So exactly what that means is unclear in the extreme. It could mean that their emissions will continue to rise for the next 40 or 50 years. And we just not as fast as they would have modeled at some point in the past that we don't quite understand. You have base years of 1990, you have base years of 2005, if you want to move the goalposts a little bit. Just trying to get everything on the same set of metrics is going to be next to impossible for 196 nations, although I suspect that there will be different ways of trying to compare one party to a handful of others. Great. So on that uplifting note, on the difficulties of measurement, let's thank our participants again.